start with the second session, I think we should not waste time. May I now request Professor Prakash Chandra Agrawal, Principal Regional Institute of Education, kindly to come forward and deliver his talk. Professor Prakash Chandra Agrawal.
Esteemed dignitaries on the dais, of the dais, I thank profusely Argus Education for inviting me and give this opportunity. As we all know that now we have 21st century's first education policy, NEP 2020, which is third, first came in 1968, second in 1986, and this is after a long gap of 34 years. And we all know that other policies worked on education, but even then we could produce only unskilled workers and not skilled workforce. So this policy is emphasizing on creating skilled workers. At the same time, we have to see our own culture, our own heritage, own tradition and ethos. And this NEP is envisaging, probably this is the reason that we are producing unskilled workforce, because we have switched over from our own traditions, own culture. And we are following Western culture, and there is a gap, and that's why we are not doing our best. Since the topic is restructuring, I'll just highlight a few points, few things here. And this policy envisages that education, formal education, should start at the age of 3. This policy for school education is suggesting restructure 5+3+3+4, where we say that orientation of child should start at the age of 3, not formal education that way, but at least we should take care. So this policy is envisaging, or we know that only early childhood education is not important, but care is also important. So few ministries, they have to work together, because we want healthy child with proper nourishment and with proper pathway for future development. Then this policy talks about, and we have to restructure our scenario, that we have to emphasize on foundations, foundational literacy and numeracy. Unless communication skills are proper, we cannot produce global citizens. And at the same time, language is not a barrier. This policy sees that language is not a barrier. We also, as academicians, as students, realize that language should not be a barrier. All the languages should be promoted equally. The language conflict is taken care of by this policy. At the same time, everyone should become the part and parcel of education system. So the third chapter talks about the dropout curtailment. Curtailment of dropout, universal access. Everyone has right to get education. And we should reach to everyone. It should be accessible to everyone. And for that, even we can leverage digital technology. But at the same time, we have to see many other factors, as Professor Basa told. Since we want to bring everyone in this system, then education should be compatible for their cognitive level, for their different dimensions. So fourth chapter talks about curriculum, pedagogy and assessment. What to do, how to do, that is very important. We have to see our curriculum. So far, the curriculum could not interest in students. So we have to review our curriculum. Curriculum formation, curriculum construction is one way, and how it is transacted, that is another way. So to bring all the students, all the learners in the educational scenario perfectly, we have to remove silos, we have to remove gaps, and that's why any subject choice should be given. There should not be any separation between academic and vocational stream. No one is better and no one is worse. And nothing like arts, nothing like science, nothing like academic stream, nothing like vocational stream. Curricular activities, extracurricular activities. Now our curriculum talks that every activity is curricular. Nothing is extracurricular. So we have to bring all such things this way, and we have to restructure our school education. I am talking firstly about school education, because unless we improve our school education, we give ample opportunity to learners to build their personality holistically in school education, they will not be properly harnessed for higher education, or higher education will not be become better. So curriculum, we have to look into it, and it should be according to the choice of learners. Local specific context must be there, because India is rich in cultural heritage, ethos, traditions, and we have to be local specific for that. Curriculum should be local. Even we can have district wise curriculum or locality wise curriculum. This is a challenge though, but at NCERT develops national curriculum framework at national level, but this can be contextualized by local community, by local administration, according to local requirements. So curriculum is very, very important. Why? Because this gives us vision that how we are going to build our future generation. Then about pedagogy, we have seen so many pedagogies so far, but this policy encompasses all, and they are, this policy is with our recommendations, with academia's recommendations, is recommending experiential learning. Now, what is experiential learning? So experiential learning means the learning should become experience of a learner, and not, it should not be an information which is rote memorized. In our curriculum, in our pedagogy, we will again feel a gap, and the students will not be able to do better. So experiential learning is emphasized, and for that we say that technology will dry out all the things, but at the same time teacher's role will remain there, and that will become even more important, because this will be the responsibility of teacher to produce, to provide conducive environment, the conducive learning situations. And we talk about assessment also. So we talk that assessment, we are now emphasizing on summative assessment, but not only summative assessment is important, rather we should focus more on adaptive and formative assessment, where assessment is there when formation of knowledge is taking place in classes, in field, or beyond classes. And in that assessment, it is important that this assessment is not only for of learners, this assessment is of teachers also, of facilitators also. If one situation, if one strategy is not working, then teacher has to revise strategy. Even if language is not compatible with learner, then teacher has to learn language of learner. So learner should be autonomous, learner should be given ample opportunities, learner. And when we are talking about classes, then every learner is important for us. No one should be left out. So when we talk about gross enrollment ratio, then enrollment ratio should become 100% in school education. It envisages that by 2030, the enrollment should be 100%, and this enrollment should be sustainable. It is not like that at the class of 8, 50% students are leaving, or 10% students are leaving. At the class of 10, some students are leaving. We have to maintain the enrollment. Sustainable enrollment must be there. For that, we have to address infrastructural shortcomings, human resources, accessibility. If you want to include all, as we are visioning for GER, gross enrollment ratio, then we have to provide all the facilities for each one, for socio-economically disadvantaged groups, for Divyangs, for disabled persons, for differently abled persons, for gifted children. So we have to create an environment where every can brought under this umbrella and can get opportunity to learn further. So assessment should be formative, and less emphasis should be given on summative assessment. Pedagogy should be experiential, and curriculum should be relooked after every 5 years, and it should be updated according to the need of nation, society, community, and international arena. And we talk about inclusive education. Everyone is important, so everyone should be brought in this picture, in this arena, under this umbrella. Now, I would like to talk about teacher education, because my institute is teacher education. Unless we produce good quality teachers, then education cannot be that much better as we expect. So to produce quality teachers, teacher education curriculum should also to be looked upon. And candidates who prefer teaching by choice should enter in this job, not those prefer by chance. So we have to check that teaching aptitude candidates should enter in teaching, and they should be ready to work with children, with learner, and they should also be able to involve community and society. Unless community involvement is there, unless civil society's involvement is there, our education cannot improve. So for that, we have to recruit good candidates for this professional course. NEP 2020 is highlighting that stand-alone B.Ed. colleges should be closed down. 90%, this is written there in the policy itself, that 90% of teacher education institutions are not up to the mark. They are just selling degrees. So we have to check such institutes. Unless teacher education is improved, we will not be able to produce quality teachers. And unless we have quality teachers, we will not be able to do good for our future generations, for learners, for youngers. So teacher education should be looked upon. And now this has been shifted to higher education few years back. Earlier, in many states, still it is not in higher education. So we have to revamp teacher education properly. And children, they should get scope to work, to think. So we say that teacher education should produce teachers who can imbibe 21st century skills among children, among learners, who can give space to learners to think critically, to reflect critically, creativity, innovativeness, all these things are required. And when we talk about startups, incubation centers, unless innovation is there, unless creativity is there, we'll not be able to do better. As we have learned that India is third in startup scheme after US, China. So we have further to increase it in such a way that India should become one, not US, and it should actually produce challenge. And for that, we have to create learners who have their own thinking, creativity, those who have innovativeness. So that's why this education policy is talking about multidisciplinary approach, talking about removing boundaries, talking about to give more space to think, to reflect. It is talking that the curricular load should be reduced. We are just putting up many things in their curriculum. Environmentalists say that environmental education should be there in the curriculum. Legal personals, they say that legal education should be there. Financiers say that financial education should be there. So we have to think especially about school education, and that especially about till eighth class, that what should be in their curriculum, because they are just burdened by this curriculum and they don't have enough scope to think, to critically think, to learn, to de-learn, relearn, and to reflect. So we have to see all these things, because in higher education, or even in secondary stage of school education, we are talking about integration of different subjects. Now, organic farming, artificial intelligence, robotics, machine language, data science. Unless we integrate, unless we bring these subjects in our curriculum, we will not be able to give enough choice, enough chance for our coming learners. So we have to bring all these things, but at the same time, this should not become a burden. That's why this education policy talks about flexibility, academic bank of credit, multiple exit, multiple entry. So a student should be given, a learner should be given this chance that suppose she showed a firstly interest in one subject, she joined, but later on she felt that she is not able to do good in this subject, she should be given opportunity to change the subject. So vocational education is also very important for us, and so far vocational education is not in that good position, we all know. Unless we emphasize, we restructure our schools, our system, education system in such a way that vocation education is given importance, we will not be able to create skilled workforce. So for that, we should identify what are the local community needs, and the skill mapping should be there, the courses, the programs should be mapped accordingly, and those courses should be initiated, should be started there. For that, we should have Meru type of universities, good universities having a large number of students, only then different combinations of subjects are possible. In a smaller institute, different subject combinations are not possible because infrastructural shortcomings are even there. Shortage of classroom, shortage of teachers, shortage of lab staff, etc., etc. So that's why this policy is talking about three types of higher education institutions: research intensive university, academic autonomous college. So in all these three types of universities, we have to think about vocational education, and for that, this policy speaks that right from the class 6, 7th, 8th, students should have a fun type of work for 10 days. They should be exposed with local artisans, local crafts, carpenters, metal workers, electric workers, gardeners, like this. These vocations can be different in different locations. So what will happen? Students will start thinking about those vocations there itself, and they will also respect the dignity of those artisans, those vocal crafts persons. Since we are just experiencing that everyone is running towards white collar job. So India was rich, India was golden bird, Sone ki chidiya. How it was? Because education was given in such a way that everyone was getting good job. This policy, that's why it talks about that we should create learners who are not job seekers, rather job creators. They should develop their own entrepreneurs. They should start their starts up. And few learners, few pursuants can come together.
Professor Agrawal, could you please conclude?
Yeah, yeah. So, 2 minutes, sir. 1 minute. So we should have linkages with industry, as has been told in previous session, inaugural session, that industry is to be linked. School education and higher education should have a well link. This, right now, we are feeling gap. So there should be a smooth transaction of children from school education to higher education. We should include civil societies and community. Unless community will think that the children are their own and are learning in their schools, they will not feel belongingness to the educational institutions. Educational institutions will not grow the way we expect. So with these words, I thank once again the organizers, and I thank my chairperson. Thank you.